Today, it is a real pleasure to introduce you all to Shona Perkins. Shona is an outdoor photographer based in Edinburgh. She's got a real deep connection with the coastline and uses her connection with this to create her photographs. She predominantly does seascape and ICM work and has created her own photography business off the back of this called My Beautiful Scotland. Her love for the coast stems way back to her childhood, and we talk about this along with how she's been able to make a business out of doing exactly what she loves. So please join me in welcoming Shona Perkins.
So I just wanted to basically get you to introduce yourself a little bit. So for anyone who doesn't know who Shona is and what you do sort of photographically, could you let everybody know?
Well, I moved to Scotland about 12 years ago and fell completely in love with the landscape here. And whilst I've been photographing everything for most of my life, I probably started photography properly with my first DSLR camera about 6 years ago. I love ICM photography, abstract photography, and seascape photography in particular, and spend most of my time on the coast photographing seascapes and experimenting with different movements and creative photography. So that sort of led to me starting my own business, My Beautiful Scotland, which I'm now lucky enough to do full time. That's a little bit about me.
That's brilliant. It's so nice when you have such a passion like photography and you're able to then make it into a full-time business, because it's not easy to do that, is it?
No, absolutely not. And it's not just going out with your camera and enjoying the beauty that is photography. There's everything else that comes with it, all the administration and the less exciting tasks, should we say, that aren't quite as fun.
It's good to recognize that, because I think a lot of people who look at the us who do photography professionally, they think, oh, it's amazing, you're always out with your camera and you're always doing things, and they may look at things like services we may have or products that we may have, but people don't realize how much admin goes on behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Planning goes on, so
I mean, I feel sometimes I'm lucky enough to get out once a week, twice if I'm very, very lucky, so yeah.
I can totally resonate with you there. That sounds exactly like my life as well. So in terms of your business, just for anyone that doesn't know, of course, you've just explained what type of photography you do, but what sort of things do you offer within your business?
Well, I my background is has been in retail management. I was a senior regional manager for a big retailer, fashion retailer, for 20 plus years. A few years ago, I faced redundancy, which sort of put me on this whole journey, really, in terms of into the life that I've created for myself now. So whilst it was really, really challenging and really difficult for me at the time, actually, in hindsight, it's probably one of the best things that's ever happened to me. So I went through some particularly difficult, dark places when I was first made redundancy. I came out of a career that was incredibly busy, definitely not 9 to 5, traveling all across the country, spending a lot of time in London. And yeah, I think to be honest, I suffered a bit of burnout, and I was, for the first time in 20 years, not knowing what I was going to do. And it was then that I kind of took to photography, and it gave me something really powerful, and that mindfulness that I craved. And that, do you know where I'm coming from? And it's sometimes really hard to articulate, but I came from such a busy career that I didn't know how to just stop and do nothing, and I needed some time out, and I took some time out. And in that first 2 years, I kind of just absolutely threw myself into photography and completely immersed myself in photography. I enrolled with the British Academy of Photography, which was quite academic and quite challenging, but really sort of gave me a better understanding of the fundamentals of digital photography, when I'd been playing around with point and shoot cameras most of my life. So, you know, that was really, really good. I traveled all over Scotland, you know, North Coast 500 very slowly, and I was lucky enough to be able to sort of really take that time to decide, right, okay, what do I want to do? Mm-hmm. That then sort of stumbled into My Beautiful Scotland, which is an online shop. I have a second online shop as well, which is a non-photography based retailer, is in my blood. So it's, you know, fundamentally what I'm going to be doing. And yeah, it's my two passions, photography, retail, business. I absolutely love it. So I'm lucky enough to now be able to do that full time. And I've also just started one-to-one tuition as well, focusing very much on the creative style of ICM photography. And I feel that whilst, you know, there's some fantastic resources out there, such as the ICM photography magazine and the, you know, the online network, which is amazing, I didn't feel that there was an awful lot out there in terms of getting hands-on with somebody, which I think ICM really, really needs. So I'm really excited. Whilst at the beginning of that, I'm really excited as to where that might go.
That's beautiful. It's really nice that you were able to turn such a difficult time of your life into something quite positive, and actually to find that mindful outlet. You know, for somebody who maybe comes from the retail industry, people may expect you to go maybe more into photographing people or more into photographing fashion style stuff. And it's interesting to see that you went in a totally opposite direction.
I know. I actually now find myself, I think I just spent too many years with too many people, and now want to live as remotely and as quietly as I possibly can. And ultimately, the longer term dream is to sort of, you know, I currently live in Edinburgh, and that's starting to feel a little too busy for me. So ultimately, the long term dream is to sort of move to the Highlands, the Islands, and live a much more remote, quiet life.
That sounds sublime. Oh, yeah. Love the sound of that. So kind of going towards more your photography and everything, why do you think you're so drawn to the sea and the ocean particularly?
Well, I've always loved the sea from childhood. I grew up, obviously I haven't got a Scottish accent, I grew up in the south of England and holidayed in Cornwall, and the Cornish beaches are like nowhere else. They're, you know, they're really fantastic. And yeah, I've always loved the sea. I find, you know, it's a fully immersive experience, isn't it? And, you know, it's just, I want to live somewhere where I can hear the sea, where I can hear the sound of the sea and go to sleep with the sound of the sea. There's just something really, really powerful about the emotions that the sea can give. I mean, it really has a healing power, and we know it has a physical healing power, but it also has mental qualities as well. I am very drawn to that, and I particularly like a beach when you're on your own. I mean, obviously photographing sunsets and sunrises, yes, you can go to very popular beaches, but you can find yourself there on your own on this beach, and it really is a wonderful experience.
It's beautiful, isn't it? I was very fortunate to be brought up in a seaside village. And there was a few years of my life, well, about 2 years ago, where I didn't live by the sea, and I really struggled. I'm now fortunate to live in a town that's right beside the sea. It's not quite as nice as the village I was brought up in, but just to be near the sea, I totally get why you want that close proximity to it. And, you know, speaking about the healing power of the sea, I 100% feel that. You know, the sea has always been there for me, and it's why I love the sea and mostly, well, the coastline as a whole in my own photography and my own photography journey. And I love there how you reconnect back to your childhood, you know, growing up on the Cornish coast and having the sea, and then going to live this really busy, crazy life away from that in the cities. And now you're like, do you know what? I want to reconnect with my child again. I want to go back to the beaches and the seaside that I was brought up in. And I'm noticing this a lot in my work. I keep saying to people, reconnect with your inner child. What did you like as a child? And that's what's happened to you. It's amazing.
Absolutely. I have memories. I mean, we went on holiday to Durness when I was 1987, believe it or not. I remember swimming in the sea there at Sango Sands as a child. when you don't feel the cold, because I don't know if I could do that now. And I admire all of the wild swimmers out there, and I would love to do that. But
it's amazing, just to say, you could definitely get back into it.
maybe. But there's nothing more amazing than just being by the sea, in the sea, listening to the sea. And it's just a really, really, as I say, powerful experience when you're on a really beautiful beach.
Mm. And what I love about your website is there's quite a few quotes on your website that are kind of very emotive, and it's about your connection with the sea, your connection with photography, and, you know, ICM also specifically. Yeah. And I love one of the quotes that says, "Seeing is not enough. You have to feel what you photograph." I wanted you to kind of explain this a little bit, because I'm realizing now how important feeling is in life, and especially when it comes to creativity. You know, if you don't feel into what you're photographing or you're painting or you're writing about, then you don't have that full immersive experience. So when you arrive on location, how do you go through the process of feeling into what's going on around you?
I do really like that quote, and I particularly resonated with that quote, hence why I put it on my website. And there was another one quite similar where, I can't remember the person, but it was, when you're photographing a person, you're photographing their soul. And again, it's finding that emotion. And I find that when you go on a location and you go on a shoot, you'll come away usually with photographs that reflect your state of mind at that time. And I know some of my photos from Harris, which I've shared with you, which obviously we're going to talk about. I was going through a particularly difficult part, well, just a difficult time last year when I went to Harris, and the series of photographs that came from that, I felt really reflected my state of mind at the time. It's really hard to articulate, but yeah, I definitely feel that, especially with ICM, you have to be able to visualize what it is you're trying to create before you take it, because you're not seeing it in front of you, and that's the biggest challenge. So I'll go on a shoot with a vision in front of me, in my mind, of what I want to create, and usually it's reflective of the state of mind that I'm in at the time.
Mm-hmm. That's a really beautiful thing to think about, actually, that your photography is reflecting your state of mind.
I think so.
Yeah, and I think, you know, a lot of people who go out sometimes and they don't come home with images, and they often feel really disheartened about that. But I often find, if you're disconnected with yourself in that moment, sometimes you just need to get outdoors, and it's not actually about taking the photographs, and it's about realizing, actually, I'm not quite in that state of mind right now to be creative, and that's okay. Just accept it. But when you are in that place, you suddenly go to the same locations and it just flows out of you. I actually think it's probably would be a really good time now, actually, to get up some of the images that you were speaking about, and particularly the ICM shots from Harris. And I kind of think it would be interesting for you to speak further through these images, and kind of what sort of emotions you feel they're portraying and why you shot them the way you did. So we'll begin with this image here.
Okay. So this one, just to put some context, when I went to Harris last year, it was my second visit to Harris. It's my third visit to Harris, sorry. And it is a magical place. And Harris really conjures up so many emotions for me. All very good emotions. But last year in particular, I had made the decision to leave the job I was in. I was working in Edinburgh with a retailer, and I was managing my two online businesses at the same time. And whilst I had luckily some flexible working with my job, and I was still literally taking on far too much, and it was all becoming too much for me, and it had become a very, very difficult decision. But it was very apparent that I needed to make that decision, and I knew that I wasn't going to give up what I'd put into my businesses. So I'd made the decision to leave that job, and my last day was literally 2 days before we went to Harris, and it was really quite bittersweet. Not that I regretted the decision, just it was just a difficult challenging decision to make, and a little overwhelming and a little scary. And we arrived on Harris and I was absolutely exhausted. I had not stopped working. I'd been in and out of furlough through the pandemic. Leading a team through that was particularly challenging. The stress and the pressure that came with, on, you know, we're in a retail business. Is this retail business going to survive the pandemic? Having to go through some horrendous kind of, you know, things within the teams, supporting closures and stuff like that. I mean, it was just a really, really difficult time. And I know everybody's got their pandemic stories and had their challenges, but we got to Harris, and to be completely honest, at first all I wanted to do was sleep. I really was exhausted, but it was when we, you know, we always go back to Luskentyre Beach when we first arrived back in Harris, and it's, and that this one here is Luskentyre Beach, and it's just, you can't put into words that feeling that you get, and that these feelings of relief came over me, and, you know, and just so many emotions. And I almost feel it by looking at this now, and I wanted to just be able to capture the beauty in a quite a raw way, and the colors and the whole and feel of the environment. So this collection was called I named Echoes and Whispers Harris, just to really sort of translate the haunting beauty of Harris and that emotion that was conjured up inside of me. And I had a wonderful break. It was a 2-week break, and I had a really, really, really good, well-needed rest, but it just made me feel very present, and very, very sure of that I've made the right decision, and I'm ready to sort of, you know, move on within my new direction.
That's beautiful. I know quite a few photographers who have such a deep connection with Harris, and particularly, you know, the beaches. I've been there 3 times myself, so I totally resonate with those feelings. And it's just it's so nice to hear the amount of people that go over there, and especially photographers and creatives, and have this connection with it. It's such a special place, and it's interesting hearing you speak about your story there, and the fact that when you arrived you were incredibly exhausted, but then you were coming out and being creative, and you were immersing your senses and becoming present. Because, like, when I look at this image, I feel all those emotions that you're talking about. You know, the mountains, because of the blurred sort of effect of them, you almost feel like that sleepy tiredness when you look at the mountain. But then you've got the beauty and the presentness of the beach all mashed into one.
Yeah, I think as well, another part for me was that sense of calm that Harris gave me at probably the most needed time. And actually, this was early in the morning. There was a lot of har about, as you can probably tell. The wind was bitter, slapping us in the face, sideways rain, you know. I remember the morning so clearly, but even that, the colours just spoke to me. I mean, look at it; it's absolutely stunning. It wasn't a calm environment at the time, but it left me feeling calm, and I wanted that to portray in the image.
Definitely. If you've got kind of all that going on there, which is, it's like, like you say, amongst all that turbulence of the weather, which you can kind of see in the top half of this image, you've got that beauty and tranquility, which the bottom half of the image sort of portrays. So yeah. I love hearing photographers speak about why they shot an image and the emotions behind it and what they were going through at that time, because the image begins to come to life. You know, some people can look at an image and, you know, whether they resonate with that image or not, you know, people look at images and they go, oh, I'm not sure about that. But when you hear the story behind it, it just comes to life. And it's so beautiful to hear you kind of speaking about that. And this shot here, I mean, me personally, I particularly love this image. Just the shapes and the patterns within it, and the mixture of that very typical Scottish Highland but Harrisy colour. You kind of get over on the west and the Outer Hebrides particularly. I'd love you to speak through this image a little bit more and kind of.
So this one also Luskentyre Beach, and just pointing the other direction to the previous one. So you've got the North Harris Mountains here, and you know, this is a a real iconic viewpoint for photographers in Harris, and even just tourists that enjoy going to Harris. Everybody loves this view, and I just, you know, the sun had set, it was getting quite dark, the tones were beautiful, and I just wanted to capture it in a slightly different way, and in a ghostly way. So this was just it, one single shot in camera, wavy, following, literally I traced the mountains with my camera over about 2 seconds. I did it a number of times, trust me, there was quite a few shots. This one made the cut. I loved the way that this made me feel. And I really love this time of night when you get that silver on the sea, that silver glow on the sea. It's definitely, I do enjoy Blue Hour and the tones that come from that time of night.
It's a beautiful time, isn't it? I find a lot of photographers need to miss that time. They kind of stay for sunset and they disappear. But actually, those blue hours that you get, it's not just the colour, is it? It's the stillness sometimes and the silence and that coupled with the beauty. And when you're somewhere like Harris that's got all of this emotive, you know, feelings to it as it is, and that inspires so many creatives. You know, this image, as you say, it's an iconic spot, but you've captured it in a completely different way. And while you can tell it's Harris and that it's probably Luskintyre, it's almost like this isn't the Luskintyre I know, because it's so creative and different.
This one is one of my favorites, and it brings back some very special memories. Another thing I have to say I like about Blue Hour is, especially when you're on Luskintyre beach at sunset and you've got a lot of, you know, people, yeah, quite rightly sitting watching the sunset, but I do find that, you know, they all disperse, like you said, as soon as that sunset. So yeah, I think my husband and I were the only two left on the beach at this time, so it was pretty special.
Oh, I love those moments, you know, when you're at either really early in the morning and you're the first person on that beach on the fresh sand, or when you're out late at night when you see everybody else has gone home and you're still standing there. And it's, yeah, there's something really special about being alone on a beach at that time of day.
Yeah, definitely.
Just can't beat it. And then you've got another beach here as well on Harris. And this has got a very different sort of feel to it. Well, different tones. You've got an almost creamy tone, you know, going through the sand here.
That was intentional. This is from Salibost, and the beauty about Salibost is obviously the tides, and when you get that low tide there, you can get some amazing, beautiful colours. So I really wanted to be able to capture the sand, the beautiful reflections that was coming from the wet sand, and then that turquoise from the shallow waters. Some pretty crazy movements used to create this. A number of shots I took when I took this, and quite a few that I like. And I even liked a couple where I literally just panned back and forth, where you kind of smoothed out the mountains a little bit. You still got those tones from the retreating tide there. So this one really, what I like about this is the colours and what Salibost is about, really.
Yeah, and it's really interesting when you think of the Outer Hebrides as a whole, like I've seen the amount of creatives that have been inspired by it. And this image, you've almost got all the colour palettes of the Outer Hebrides, apart from maybe the brownie colours, but you know, you've got the blues and the greens and the sort of blacky greys and the turquoises, and there's you know, that very well-known colour palette of sort of Harris and Lewis that you hear writers write about and painters try to articulate and put into their paintings. And you know, you've kind of captured all of those tones in this image, well, almost all of them, and you really get that feeling of what Harris is about from a colour perspective, which is beautiful.
Thank you.
And kind of just going away from ICM for a moment, you've got this beautiful image that you sent of, I'm guessing it's also a sunset or a sunrise, and you've got
sunrise,
fantastic. Yeah. You've got the beautiful mountains here and that layering. I think this is what makes this image, is that layering of the landscape here. I'd love you to kind of speak through this shot, because it's obviously very different to your ICM.
Yes, I do. I do still take what conventional landscape photography, and I do still enjoy it. If I'm being honest, I do feel like I'm being drawn more and more towards the abstract and more creative style of photography. But this here was, you know, this scene was, it was beautiful, and I was with my husband. This was actually March. This year we went on holiday up to Westeros, which was fantastic, and this was taken from Firemore Beach, which is on Loch Ewe. Absolutely stunning part of the world, and our first time up that side of Loch Ewe. It was sunrise, we'd gone out. I had all the intentions of ICM. I did have my tripod with me, but there's an awful lot of times I go out now and I just leave the tripod back in the car. But no, thankfully I did have my tripod, because what you touched on earlier about sometimes when you go out and you feel frustrated because you walk away without any images, that's how this morning was starting out for me. And, you know, I was feeling a little bit frustrated because it was my first time to this location, to be fair. But I just wasn't getting the feeling or the inspiration or the motivation that I get that draws me and creates that vision for me to be able to create ICM. Mm-hmm. So I said to Shane, my husband, right, let's just go up that cliff up there and let's just sit and watch the sunrise, because it's just not happening. Mm-hmm. So we did, and this happened. It was just, thank God I had the tripod. And it was beautiful, and I took a couple of shots, but we also got to just sit down and watch that. And what a beautiful part of the world, and really, really stunning.
It's really inspiring there, I think, to listen to you, you know, trying the ICM and realizing it wasn't working, and then to go back to your more conventional photography. Because I find this is what some people tend to do with their photography. They'll go out and they'll have a particular image or a particular technique in mind, and they'll try it out. And if it's not working, a lot of people will just give up. Whereas it's really nice to see that you kind of were trying what you were intending to do, it wasn't working, and you have the open-mindedness to just say, let's just enjoy this moment, let's walk a little bit further up the hill, and bang, everything just came together for you. And
it was very lucky, yeah. This was what I would call a lucky shot. And then I also have to remember that, you know, I was on holiday with my husband, and, you know, he's fantastic in the respect that he'll get up early in the morning to come to these locations with me to enjoy it as much as me. But I can't then just say, no, okay, I'm not getting anywhere, so let's just go home. So yeah, it's difficult. I've opened up quite a bit recently and admitted and spoken out about the fact that I do have quite a bit of creative anxiety, and I've suffered with that for years. I suffered with it in my career, and this is very much part of how I'm trying to deal with it, is that it's okay, it's absolutely okay if I'm not going to get a shot, if I'm not feeling it, if I can't see what I'm trying to create, then just stop. But still enjoy where you are, and try not to let those awful feelings and those niggling little voices in your head actually ruin that experience. So this was one where actually, do you know what? I didn't go home. We went to watch the sunrise, and then this beautiful scene unfolded. So it just goes to show.
Yeah, thank you for sharing there about the sort of creative anxiety things. I think we all sort of have that as creatives. I used to get it with my photography. I don't so much anymore, but I definitely get it with my YouTube channel. I film videos and then I think, I can't put this out there. And I'm like, why can't you put it out there? You're reacting to a moment. But I'm like, so much anxiety about what other people may think of what I'm saying, what I'm doing. Yeah. And it just gets me so much. And sometimes I'll film a video and I'll edit it and I'll be so proud of it. But then when it actually comes to publishing it, I'm like, no, this happened 2 days ago. I'm not in that space anymore. I can't show people this. And that turmoil that goes on inside of me, it's just like sharing so much with the world. But it's the same, obviously, you know, with your photography there. And it's nice that you're opening up about that, because the more people, I think, who open up about this creative anxiety and worrying about us not being able to express ourselves or what other people will think of our expressions, Like, it can be really crippling, can't it?
Oh, absolutely. And what really amazed me when I did first open up about this was the amount of people, creatives, artists, photographers, actors, I mean, anybody in a creative industry that suffer from it too. I mean, you know, so that's almost, you know, quite heartwarming in a way that, you know, you're not the only person feeling like this, and that actually it's absolutely fine to feel like this and to talk about this, and other people will relate and understand. So that was a good thing.
Definitely. I think I've heard a few stories of like really famous actors and people who do like plays and stuff, and they get crippled with anxiety before going on stage. They're physically being sick, and but then when they get out there, they're fine. But it's like that anxiety of going out there and performing, even if they're like incredible at what they do, it's like it's interesting, as you say, you know, every creative I think at some point in their life feels that way, and I think the more of us that speak out about it, definitely the better. It's great, you know, with you having this connection to the sea, that you also seem to have this connection with lighthouses. There's a few images that you've sent in of lighthouses, and the first one I want to share is this beautiful shot of Rattray Head, which is the lighthouse that I visit the most because it's closest to my house. I've got a very deep connection with this location. But what I love about this image is the sort of colour palette that you've got, and the tones within it are very different to the majority of the Rattray Head images I've seen. So yeah, I'd love to hear your thought process behind capturing this and the colours and the tones that you've managed to portray within it.
You're very lucky you live so close. It's a wonderful, wonderful location, but about 4 hours away for me, so not one I go to very often. This was my birthday last year, my birthday treat, to get up at the crack of dawn to come and photograph Rattray Head. This morning was, and I'm sure you've experienced northeast weather like this, but the morning it was one of the worst storms that I've been in. And I was stood on the beach with my husband and my dog, trying to sort of keep dry. The wind was absolutely ferocious. So we headed to the dunes to try and sort of just shelter as best we could. And obviously the dunes are very big at Rattray Head, so it did give us the shelter. And needless to say, the rain stopped, and that's what presented itself. So again, not a planned shot, but yeah, the colour of the sky was absolutely fantastic. It was, when I look back at the raw images, you know, you've got real deep purples there. It was really fantastic, and again, those silver tones on the sea that I really love. And again, I really wanted to try and capture that movement in the grass to try and show that, you know, there was quite a stiff breeze going on there, and you just had a really faint hint of colour on the horizon there. It was a stunning morning, and we were so lucky on this trip. You know, we got to experience these conditions in the morning, and then a wonderful sunset that night when we went back with pink skies, and yeah, it was a really fantastic weekend.
Beautiful. I think what I like about your images as well is you seem to have a very soft sort of tones and colours within your images. Is that a conscious thing? Like, do you maybe like capture them that way? Do you edit them that way? There's a very softness to your images. You know, you don't go down that route of really drawing up the colours and drawing out the contrasts. There's just lovely feeling to your images.
It's funny because I really do love, like, one of an ICM artist that I particularly admire, her images couldn't be any further away from what mine are like. So I do really appreciate vibrancy and colour and intense, you know, feelings, but I just don't seem to capture that. And I do tend to, when I'm editing, I will reduce contrast. I do reduce vibrancy. Quite often I'll even reduce clarity. So, because I've been asked quite a bit about this in terms of editing, a recent event I did, there was a few questions around that, and people were really quite surprised that I did that, because a lot of the time people do the reverse. But I do like the softness to images, and it is kind of what I try to capture as well. And if I don't, then I will reduce in the editing processing.
I think the way you edit gives the images a much more relaxed feeling of them in some ways. And it's interesting actually, because the way you edit is a total opposite to how I edit. I probably go down the route of what most sort of maybe people do, but it's lovely to hear. And this is the thing about editing, like people always say, how do you edit your images? But it's like, it doesn't actually matter, because editing is your way of having the image as you want it and how you feel it should be seen. And you know, when we start copying other people, we get rid of that authenticity. And it's lovely actually to hear that you kind of do the reverse of what most people do. And as a result, you've got very different feelings and tones and emotions ending up in your final images, which is lovely.
Thank you.
And another shot of a lighthouse is this one here of Barnes Ness. Now, I went to Barnes Ness last year for the first time, and the images that I got are completely far removed from what you've shot here. And I love that you've gone down into the grasses. I imagine you were probably quite low to the ground.
Yeah.
The grasses aren't particularly high there.
No.
So you've got a very different perspective of this lighthouse to what I had. And I would love to just hear your thoughts behind this image.
It's good to hear that you've been. This one's local to me. I love Barnes Ness Lighthouse, and it's a beautiful location in some respects. But then actually, if in others, you've got a big power station right behind it. So it can look quite harsh, and you have got to find the right composition to get something. And I've seen lots of images of Barnes Ness Lighthouse as well, and I've seen some great images, but I do find it's quite difficult to capture. So I have tried for a number of years, and finally got this one, which I'm really happy with. I was always wanting the contrast of that, you know, because I believe it's 35 meters, I could be wrong, but it's a big, towering, tall lighthouse. It's a fantastic structure. And I wanted that, you know, offset against the dark contrast of it, you know, a moody sky. So again, this was in and around sunset, obviously no color, but really, really lovely tones. Again, very, very breezy. So again, I used quite a slow shutter speed there to really capture the movement of the grass. And yeah, I think I was lying down with the tripod in a really weird position to try and capture this. I was really happy with how it turned out, because it's a challenging location.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, when I was there, we had a rainbow and the light was incredible. The sky was just, it was a totally unplanned thing. I just went to scout it out, and I ended up getting a shot that I was hoping to get, you know, another day. Mm-hmm. But I just remember, as you say, there was that power station behind it, and there's a lot of kind of just distractions. And even in my final image, there is that distractions, but you don't see them as much because the rainbow and the light were so overpowering.
Yeah.
While you had all that stuff in the background that was a bit, you know, doesn't really play in with the scene, I had the light, whereas obviously on this night you didn't have the light, and it was about getting creative and about getting low to the ground and playing around with your shutter speeds and trying to make the most of those clouds and those tones that you did have. And yeah, you've just got a lovely calming image here, which is really, really nice to see. There's a few shots that you've taken of different things in the sea, and one here of what I'm imagining is a windsurfer. It's quite a creative shot because you've got that intense sort of orangey redness there against the blue tones that you're so used to shooting.
Yeah. Pop of colour for the first time for me. I think somebody actually commented on that. And this one is Gullen Beach in East Lothian, one of my favourite beaches. And I remember this one quite clearly because it was a couple of days after Storm Eunice. Is it Eunice? Storm Eunice?
Oh, I can't remember. I think it was. Yes. I can't remember.
The storm in January. So it was a couple of days after that, and it was, you know, so it was still quite breezy. And Gullen can be quite calm because it's just really at the mouth of the North Sea. But we had some really great motion and some waves here. And this was sunrise, and it was me and this lone windsurfer. And I saw him, he arrived when I did, and I was like, brilliant, yes. And really, really hard to capture, and I'm not gonna lie, I was absolutely frozen. My hands were bitter, I could barely feel the shutter button, and numerous shots to get this. He was going incredibly fast, and the thing with windsurfers though, they're going at God only knows what speeds, 40 miles an hour, but they're turning and they're going in any such direction. So to choose the right shutter speed to stay with him, but not totally with him, so he's too sharp, and you know, it really hard, but really enjoyable. And I used quite a long lens to get this, and I'll be honest, I think pot luck to get that pop of colour and him where I wanted him in the frame. So yeah, quite pleased.
A very challenging image. A few weeks ago, I interviewed Kaiser Seren, who you'll
yes,
from the ICM network, yeah. And she has, I'm sure you know, all these lovely photographs yeah. of people dancing, and it's interesting, you know, to hear how she did that, but also to now hear that you've done something similar there with the windsurfer. And it's, you know, when you're working with people and movement, you know, you're not just working with the landscape, which, you know, as you watch the waves, you can start to predict them and stuff. When you're working with people, it's so much more challenging. And then to couple that with ICM, it's a real skill to be able to actually pull it off. So yeah.
Thank you. Enjoyable, but this is what I love about it. And you know, I find ICM really challenging when you get, especially when you start adding moving subjects into it, which I really enjoy, birds as well. But it's the challenge that I find so invigorating, and yeah, it's just absolutely brilliant fun.
Yeah, it's so good that you found that with photography, you know, and to be able to challenge yourself in new creative yeah. ways, it definitely keeps the excitement up.
Yeah, definitely.
So the last image of yours I'd like to share is this shot here, which is probably one of my favourites of yours. These beautiful sailing boats all moored here. And just the lines in this and the beautiful, you know, light there of the sun coupled again with the sea, but also just how you've moved within this image to create almost like this elongation of, you know, yeah. pulling up of the sails and everything. It's yeah, it's such a nice shot, this. Love to hear
thank
your thoughts.
You. Thank you. This is this is walkable from my house. This is Granton Harbour, a really lovely place. And whilst it's so local to me, I don't often go down there. You know, it's surrounded by flats. Again, it's not necessarily where you would consider to go. I was actually on my way back from a sunrise shoot at Portobello Beach, and passed by and thought, no, do you know what? The light is really special here. I'm going to stop and I'm going to have a bit of a play with these boats. It was quite difficult because the sun had risen. So I was quite limited in terms of composition because the sun was screaming in my face. So I want to revisit this earlier, maybe with some colour. So watch this space, because I think I really enjoyed this, and I definitely think there's more to come from this. And I just used quite a slow movement, following the line of the sails, and then holding the camera still for a bit just to maintain a little bit of detail as well, and to not lose that movement in the water. So yeah, I was quite pleased with it.
Do you know what I loved there when you said the sun's screaming in your face, screaming at you? Do you know when you now look at this mirror, I see the boat screaming? It's like that motion that you've captured this in, although that's maybe not necessarily a positive to portray. When you said the sun was screaming at you, do you know the way that you've captured the sailing boats here? You can, it almost feels like the motion is like...
You can feel the movement, yeah.
Yeah, like the sound of a scream, and that like mysterious feel to it. That's just, I don't know, you said that and I was like, wow, like that kind of... That emotion is in this image when you see it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's beautiful. I mean, when you start looking at, you know, what you've kind of done here with your photography, and I think it's very clear that, especially the stories behind your image, and when you couple them with, you know, your final photographs, you can see the emotion and maybe how you're feeling and what was going on around you, and then how you've portrayed that in your image through the use of movement. It's like you are completely embodying the creative process. And I love that. It's so, so, so beautiful that you're able to do that. It really, really is.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, well, it's been an absolute joy to interview you today, Shona. I really appreciate you taking the time out to do that. And I hope that people have got something out of this in terms of, you know, just realising that the sheer power, I think, of creativity and of finding that outlet. And yeah. I wish you all the best in your dream of moving up to the Highlands and getting that nice little house by the sea that you can
absolutely
and listen to the waves.
Listen to the sea.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Oh, what a dream, what a dream. I really wish you all the best with making that a reality and with the continuing success of your photography business as well.
Oh, thank you very much, Kim, and thank you very much for inviting me to chat with you.
Very welcome. Thank you again, and okay. Yeah, take care.
Thank you.
If you would like to learn more about Shona's work, you can do so by heading to mybeautifulscotland.com.